All right. So the first question here, like I said, it's going to be a drop rate type question. And what we have is a nurse is preparing an infusion. It's a 250 milliliter unit of packed red blood cells over 2 hours. Now, as I mentioned this, let me just read the whole question. The drop factor for the IV tubing is 15 drops per milliliter. And then the question is, how many drops per minute should the nurse adjust the flow rate to? So keeping in mind, whenever we're doing drop rate, you have a simple formula to follow. You need the flow rate and you need the drop factor. Those two things will give you the drop rate, which is typically listed or noted as drops per minute. Now, at some of the other campuses, they won't give them the drop factor. The drop factor is typically in that instance, they're going to tell them that they're using micro tubing, and the drop factor then would be 60 drops per milliliter, 60 drops per milliliter. If that ever comes up, that's where that's coming from. I think most of them know that by now, but and then at Allegheny campus, you guys do not need to worry about that. All right, so I mentioned in the question that the nurse is going to be diffusing 250 milliliters over 2 hours. That is my flow rate, okay? My drop factor, which is also given to me, is the 15 drops per milliliter, okay? So even if you did nothing other than know to multiply flow rate times drop factor, you're already, leaps and bounds ahead of where you need to be. And keeping in mind that the reason I set this up from a dimensional analysis standpoint is just, it just helps to show my flow when I'm doing this. When I'm personally figuring out these questions, I just plug it into my calculator. But telling you that doesn't help you guys knowing like where the numbers go and why I'm doing that. Now, because we know we're going to be ending in minutes, okay, one of the things that I would recommend that you do is just convert hours to minutes. So you know that 1 hour is 60 minutes. And hopefully you know that 2 hours is 120 minutes, okay? Excuse me. So knowing that, now all we gotta do is get our calculator. You're gonna do 250 times 15. Which gives you 3,750, and divide that by 120, and you'll get 31.25 drops per minute. Now, you cannot give a partial drop, right? So we need to round to the nearest whole drop. That's what the instructions typically say, and that's what you need to know. Now, this may vary in the actual clinical setting, but when it comes to when we're doing the drug calc, we just need to go with what we know what to do. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to round this to 31 drops per minute. And what I mean by in a clinical setting, what I mean by that is you might be in an actual clinical setting, you might actually only set that to 30 or 35. Those might be the only options you have. So just keep that in mind when you actually do this from a clinical standpoint, and don't confuse clinical calculations with what we're doing with the math-based calculations. Another flow rate type question. Now, a typical flow rate is just volume over time. So we just need to make sure we weed out the details and we find out the volume and we find out the time. So in this question, it says that a nurse is preparing to administer clindamycin 300 milligrams via intermittent IV bolus over 30 minutes to a client who has a staph infection. What's available is the clindamycin is premixed in 50 milliliters of a 0.9% sodium chloride IV. What should the nurse set the IV pump to in milliliters per hour? So we have a couple of pieces of information here. We have 300 milligrams of the medication. We have 30 minutes is our time. And then we have a 50 milliliter IV solution. Okay, so we have three pieces of information. And the question is, how many milliliters per hour? That's the question. Okay. So I have extra information that I don't need in order to solve this problem. When you're calculating the rate, you don't need to worry about the strength because you assume that you have the right strength, that it's given there, that you pulled the right bag, that you're giving them the appropriate antibiotic. You're not giving them, you know, an antifungal. You know, you're giving them the appropriate medication. And so we don't need to account for the strength. We just need to make sure that we choose the right bag and make sure that that has that that strength within that bag. And so the way we're going to solve this problem is I'm going to take the volume over the time. So if I need to diffuse 50 milliliters in 30 minutes, but I need to set the infusion pump to milliliters per hour, the shortcut to this is you just double the milliliters. So the answer to this would be 100 milliliters per hour. But if you ever get stuck and you're not 100% sure, just remember you can always convert minutes to hours, okay? This gives you 50 times 60, if I'm not mistaken, gives you 3,000. Yeah, 3,000 divided by 30, and you'll get 100 milliliters per hour. These just standard flow rate questions are commonly missed on tests and practices, mainly just because a lot of times, you know, you as a nursing student, when I say you, I just mean the global you, are looking for more math to do. And all you need to do is get it into the right sequence, volume over time, and then we want milliliters over hours. And sometimes you just need to convert minutes to hours. If this problem had said 50 milliliters in 1 hour, then your flow rate would just be 50 milliliters per hour. But of course they want you to do some sort of math in the math settings.
Is it always going to say like third, like minutes instead of like hour on a problem?
Sometimes it'll say hours. So like, I'm going to give you the next one, okay. Says hours.
That's what I do. I want to do too much math and I'm just doing too much. That's
yep. Now, if it's in hours, you just leave it alone. If it's in minutes, you need to convert. So let me give you this next example. So it says the nurse is preparing to administer total parenteral nutrition, 1,800 milliliters. And it's to infuse over 24 hours. It even told you over 24 hours. And we just need to know what to set the IV flow pump to. So there's no math to do here. I just need to reduce the 1800 over the 24. So all you do is you take out your calculator, 1800 divided by 24, and you would program into the infusion pump 75 milliliters per hour. So in this instance, I really didn't have any math other than maybe just saying division. And you just do the volume over time and get it so it's per hour, per 1 hour. So 1,800 divided by 24 will get you there. Okay, and I saw some people were commenting. Good, yeah. All right, so those were the three problems that I wanted to work through that were in addition to what you guys have been learning. So the secret to this is with, you know, you can see here that the order is Dilantin 15 milligrams per kilogram. As soon as you see that milligram per kilogram, that automatically tells you that this is a weight-based problem. If this only said 15 milligrams and then gave us like, available dose of, 5 milligrams per tablet or whatever the case may be, we wouldn't need to worry about the weight. So like sometimes you might get the patient's weight in a problem that it doesn't matter, but for Dilantin, and in this example, it does matter. So what are some of the things that might change with this type of question? Pretty much just the patient's weight. And so what this question is really asking you to do is two things: convert pounds to kilograms, and then multiply that number by 15. Okay. So step one, convert pounds to kilograms. 176 divided by 2.2. And I believe that's 80, but let me just double check. Yeah. Gives you 80 kilograms. Once you have your kilograms of body weight, once you've made that conversion, then you just multiply by 15. If you want, you can include the things here. So 80 times 15. So you would start them off on a loading dose of 1200 milligrams, or if it had asked you how many grams would you administer, you would say 1.2 grams, okay? The extra piece of information here, the 300 milligrams per day, that already tells you how much to give per day. Another way this question might be asked is if they had given you the conversion of milligrams to milliliters, and then they might ask how much milliliters to administer per dose per day. You know, that is a variation of that question, but most likely you won't see all those steps. A lot of times they just want you to do two things. So converting pounds to kilograms and then converting kilograms to milligrams via the medication that's considered weight-based. So again, the secret here is you'll see this, the kilograms indicates that this is a weight-based type question.
So I have a question, Dr. Rad.
Yes.
If it was 80.5 kilogram, you would do 81?
Actually, no. You would round, when you go from pounds to kilograms, the rule there is to round to the nearest tenth. So let's say we got, let's just say I had an 82.45 like weight. I would round that to the nearest tenth, to 82.5, and then I would multiply by the 15.
Okay. So, and if I use the other way, like dimensional analysis, do I have to round it first or at the end?
I would say round it first, yes. In reality, you're at the end. If you wait to do the rounding at the end, it shouldn't impact the final answer. You should actually still get to the same answer without having to worry about the rounding. The thing is, like, if you're doing dimension analysis and you're writing out all these steps and you're just doing the times and following that through, the correct way to do dimensional analysis is, yes, wait until the very end to do your rounding. So if you are doing the full dimensional analysis, then yes, wait until the end, and your answer is still going to end up being it'll be the same, or at least it'll be close enough to the same that it shouldn't be a problem with your final answer.
Okay, because I would rather to use the dimensional analysis. It's easier for me.
Sure. No, that's fine. Yeah, I'm like I said, I'm an advocate of the dimensional analysis, so definitely.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Oral solution contains 0.05 milligrams per milliliter, and we want to know how many milliliters to administer. So, like I said, when you have micrograms and milligrams, those are two different units, and they're not going. You can't easily do math doing that. I don't want to say you can't do it, because if you can think in powers of thousands, then you can easily do this. But I don't. I don't think most people want to sit there and try and adapt a new skill. They just want to figure out the simplest way to answer this question. And so you could do this either way. Because 500 is by itself, it's usually what I start off with. And then I convert micrograms to milligrams, okay? 1 milligram contains 1,000 micrograms. And the other alternative is just move your decimal over 3 spaces. So 3 to the left, because we're getting to a, going up a unit. So that becomes 0.5 milligrams. So step one is you have to do the conversion in order to do this problem. Once you're there, now all you have to do is convert your milligrams to milliliters. And I think you get 10 milliliters. 0.5 divided by 0.05, yeah, 10. So if you encounter a problem like this, and you may very well, the change might be what is ordered. So if like that were 250, but it's still micrograms, you're gonna need to convert micrograms to milligrams first. The alternative is you could have converted milligrams to micrograms first, but they both need to be the same unit before you do any kind of math with them. So for 18, you have a 500 milliliter IV, it's infusing at 125 milliliters per hour, and we just wanna know how long is it gonna take. So the question ultimately is just saying, I have 500 milliliters, I wanna know how long it's gonna take to get to 0 milliliters if it's losing 125 milliliters every hour. So instinctively, if you just did 500 divided by 125, you're doing that right.
Okay, I was just looking at the 0.9%, 0.9. I'm like, wait, what is this?
That just tells you what's in the bag. So remember, when we're doing flow rates and things like that, the analogy I use is, let's say you have a yellow Volkswagen Beetle or a red Volkswagen Beetle. Does it matter which color? If you're both driving the same speed, this all you really care about is the speed. It doesn't really matter the vehicle. It doesn't matter the color. It doesn't matter, the make. It doesn't matter any of that. Okay, you can even be both driving on the wrong side of the road. It doesn't matter when we're talking about what's the speed. What's the speed? So the 0.9% we don't account for. That just tells you what's in the bag.
Okay.
So like when you're infusing, so like I'm assuming you guys have been doing some clinical stuff and like in the, whether it's in your labs or in your, or at the hospital settings and your clinical stuff, you just need to know how to program into the infusion pump how fast whatever is needing to get in there is getting in there. And so like if they're on like normal saline, just a regular IV solution, it's set to some milliliters per hour. But what if that, was something else? What if that was a hypotonic solution or a hypertonic solution? How might that differ? Really just comes down to, it doesn't matter as far as what is being infused. For these questions, all we're asking is how long will it take? And what would you program into the infusion pump? So yeah, the 0.9% is not meant to throw you off, because I could have also said the 0.9% sodium chloride, and it has 200 milligrams of Dilantin in it. Again, you would only look at the volume and the time to calculate rate-based questions.
So they're not gonna ask any, I think what's confusing me too is I'm looking at other dosage calc stuff and it's just making it worse, but they're like asking like something like this and they're saying like how many hours, and you have to like do the hours.
Yeah.
That's not this level, is it?
You have a question like that, I think.
I hope not.
Well, I mean, that's what this question is. How many hours? So how long would this infusion take? It'll take four hours.
Yes. But no, you have to like, the question was like asking the hour, and you have to say like when it would stop or when it would be done. So you have to do like the military time.
Yeah. No, there's an example of that in the, question 9, you've probably done so many times that it's gonna make you go crazy. So remember, if you have a question and it doesn't tell you per dose or per day, you assume per dose. So if I told you that your patient receives 500 milligrams POBID, you will give blank capsules. This is read per dose, okay?
Okay.
If it asked you to do per day, it will say per day. Okay.
Okay.
So, and that's usually where I understand, like on the test, it should say per dose or per day. So that should be clarified. But if it doesn't specify per day, it's per dose. Okay.
Okay.
So 250 milligrams, 500 milligrams per dose. So you just give 2 capsules per dose.
I got it, but I was just wondering, do I have to multiply by, twice, like, because it didn't specify, so I was confused a little bit about that.
Yeah, so if it doesn't specify, so think about it, like, let's say you're in a clinical setting, you are administering this to the patient, and I would just say, like, even when nurses are overworked and underpaid, they usually only doing a 10 or 12 hour shift, so you're probably only going to give one of those two doses. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay. So it's just a way to, like, that's just a silly there. I don't think that's the actual reason for any of this. I'm just giving you a silly way to kind of remember what it is that is being done here. So you just care about what you're going to give them right now. Unless it said per day, then they would do that.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome. That was a good question. And then 12. It's here somewhere. All right. Okay. This is actually good to do with the 2x. So I'll leave this here. So I don't know if you notice from Tuesday, I did a bigger font. So hopefully this is showing up a little bit clearer. I know it's still a little bit on the blurry side. So you have heparin 4,000 units subcutaneous, and it says how many milliliters will you give, and then circle the correct amount on the 2x. So what you're going to do is, so first of all, you got to look at the 2x and you got to look and find what the what your available is or what you have in stock, okay? So you can see that it's 10,000 units per milliliter, okay? So that's what that states there. And so if I'm doing dimensional analysis, which is what I'm going to show you, I'm just going to write on this. So I'm going to have 4,000, okay, units. I don't want units, I want milliliters. So I'm gonna divide by the 10,000 units per milliliter. When I do that math, I get 0.4 milliliter. Now I go to my 2x and it wants you to mark the 2x. So you can see I have one and then I have half. And then what I'm going to do is I'm just going to verify these should be increments of one. So 0.5, 0.6, 0.7, 0.8, 0.9, and then one. So that works out. So 0.5, 0.4. So if it says the circle, there's your 0.4.
Okay.
I've got it. So this would be 0.1, 0.2, or I'm sorry, this is 0.1, 0.2, 0.3, 0.4, 0.5. So zero is actually not demonstrated on this particular 2x, but that's how you would mark the 2x.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome. So 23 is doing what you've most likely been doing through most of the practice tests already. You're just going to take what you get milliliters for the visceral and then add it to whatever milliliters of the meperidine you get, and that'll give you your total volume of medication. So it's kind of like the when you mix insulins, you have two different insulins, you're going to draw up, you know, 10 units of one and 30 units of the other. You're going to do basically the same thing, except you're just going to draw up milliliters.
Okay.
So what you're going to do is you're going to take what is given to you, 60 milligrams. And then for this is for the visceral. So it says we have 50 milligrams. Oops. We have 50 milligrams per milliliter available. Sorry. It's gonna be a one and then 50. So those of you doing desire to have, you would just do 60 divided by 50, and we're gonna get to the same thing. And then for the meperidine, the order is 85 milligrams. And then 75 milligrams per milliliter. So again, if you're doing desired over half or ordered over half, 85 divided by 75 is what you would write here. You would just write this over here. I'm showing the dimensional analysis way. And again, the main reason I show it this way, and this also works for order over half, is just making sure you're crossing out your units and you're left with what you're looking for, which is milliliters. 60 divided by 50. Is 1.2. And then 85 divided by 75 is 1.1, and then 3 repeating. So what are we going to do? We're still going to add these two together, okay? And we're going to get 2.3333 repeating, okay? And then we're going to round to the nearest tenth for 2.3 milliliters.
Can you round before?
You can, yes. Okay. Like I said, for this one, it wouldn't change the answer. Because even if you ended up, like let's say this was 1.15 and you waited to round here or rounded now, you'd still come up, you'd still get to the next number up. So it would still be, ended up being like two, it would still end up being 2.4. So you would still come up with the right answer. So yeah, you can round right after you do this step here. I just showed you the alternative because just so you could see it.
Thank you.
You're welcome. For those who like to do the dimensional analysis set up all the way through, this is what that would look like. I would take my 1440 cc's over my 12 hours. I would then, so Taria, I would just say ignore what I'm showing right now. Then I would take, you can do this either way. You can go ahead and do your drop factor now. So I'll just go ahead and do that. Keeping in mind that ml and cc are the same thing, which is why they cancel out. And then I need to get rid of the hours. Okay. So if you're doing dimensional analysis, this is how that would look. And then you'd be left with drops per minute. And so before you even plug anything into your calculator, you know you set it up right. That's the whole value of doing dimensional analysis, is that you know that you've set it up correctly before you even plug it into your calculator. Even if there's a whole bunch of numbers, you'll know because you've eliminated all the things that you need. And then what that helps out with also is, like, let's say you accidentally put 60 on top and one on the bottom. If minutes are on top and hours on the bottom, you can't cancel out things that are on the same, or both in the denominator. So you would know right away, oh, this is where I'm making this mistake. And that's why I'm getting, you know, 1200 drops per minute, which doesn't make any sense. So I'll just show you the work that I did already. Give me 1 second. So what's happening in 23? Is you have two drugs, Vistaril and Meperidine, and all you're going to do is convert the milliliters, or you're going to find the milliliters of the Vistaril, then you're going to find the milliliters of the Meperidine, and you're going to add them together. And so that's what I did here. I took the 60 milligrams, and if you're doing order over half, you would do 60 over 50, and I got the 50 from the Vistaril label. And then 85 over 75, and I got that over the label. Then 60 over 50 is 1.2 milliliters. 85 over 75 is 1.13333333 repeating. You can either round off at this step, round to the nearest tenth, or what I did is I waited and I just added the two together. So 2.3333, I eliminate the extra threes, and then I would administer 2.3 milliliters total, which includes both medications.
Sorry, I'm at 24.
Oh, okay. I can barely hear you, so. Okay, 24. Okay. So 24. First of all, when we're doing this problem, it's considered a two-step problem. The first step is we need to convert pounds to kilograms, And the second step is once we have kilograms, we just need to multiply it by the weight-based drug. So in this example, the weight-based drug is Dilantin, 15 milligrams per kilogram. Okay, that's the giveaway that you need to account for the patient's weight. If this had said, calculate the loading dose, and the loading dose was to give them 15 milligrams, and there was no per kilogram, then you would just give them 15 milligrams. It didn't matter what their weight was or anything like that. But because it says per kilogram, you have to account for that. And so what you're going to do is you're going to take the patient's weight in pounds, divide by 2.2, and you get 80 kilograms. 80 times, and then you're going to multiply by the 15. So 80 times 15 gives you 1,200 milligrams. Now, if it had asked you how many grams to administer, you would convert milligrams to grams. But it didn't say to convert anything, so you would just administer 1,200 milligrams. Then when it says 300 milligrams per day, well, all the question is asking for is the loading dose. So if it asked you how much to give them on like 3 days later, you would just say 300 milligrams. And then I wrote this down here. This was someone had asked if, what if you got like a, you didn't get a whole number, what would you do? And I suggested that you round to the nearest 10th once you convert pounds to kilograms. However, if you wait and do that to the end, you still should come up with the same answer. So it probably won't matter.